Not only that, the money spent.
Oh, I
saw today that it's upwards of $1.2 billion. Is that correct?
Well, exactly. But the majority of that is not coming from Donald Trump, and he gets all the mainstream media coverage.
Well, and again, I'll use myself as an example. My father once said to me, Lindsay, that all politicians are crooks. And I said, Dad, you can't make a blanket statement. They can't all be. And he said, yes, they can. He said, because here's why. They spend $1 million for a job that only pays 100 grand.
Oh, yeah.
And in his eighth grade education, that made a lot of sense to me. And when I ran for governor of Minnesota, I only raised $300,000. I actually made more money doing the job than what I spent to get it.
And not only that, it's nothing like, you know, serving one term and then getting lifelong pensions and, of course, that handy government health insurance.
Oh,
now,
yeah.
as we get started on our special coverage tonight, we are playing hardball. We are showing you perspective the mainstream media will not. We've got correspondents across the country and the world covering this crucial election. We're live at all four major candidate watch parties from New York to New Mexico. We're also in key swing states and getting world reaction from across Europe. Let's start with a key state everyone will be watching tonight. Manuel Rapallo is live in Columbus. Manny, another year for Ohio to be in the spotlight. What do we got?
Big year for Ohio, and at least today those lines have died down. A lot of the excitement that we saw was with those long lines of early voters over the course of the last few days. Of course, we didn't hear any news of any voters not being able to vote, no voter suppression. So that's always something good to report. Now, talking to voters, whether it be here in the city of Columbus, Ohio, and Lorain and northern Ohio, where we traveled to listen to what voters really care about, the issues that they care about, what we keep hearing, we get a sense that the contentiousness of the election itself between the two major candidates, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, has really sidelined a lot of the issues that most Ohioans really do care about. And I want to give you a sense of what some of the voters that we talked to at one polling place and had to say earlier today. Take a listen.
I haven't heard as much about climate control as I'd like to hear. And yes, I think there have been a lot of red herrings on the part of one candidate trying to get us to think about things that are not policy. I believe one has to read both sides and think critically.
I learned a lot about the bond issues 1, 2, 3, and 4 that I voted for today. Unfortunately, I feel like the president kind of overshadowed a lot of the local things. But yeah, I'd say the president is probably the biggest one that everyone's here to vote for.
Sadly, I honestly think they care too much about ridiculous innuendo and not enough about actual issue, because this is obviously the worst smear campaign that's ever been run by anybody, regardless of party affiliation or anything else. Timmy, stop. So I think that's what a lot of people are focusing on, and I think that's actually kind of sad.
Now, the most common thing that we're hearing from voters here in Ohio is jobs, and that makes a lot of sense given that Ohio is in the Rust Belt. This state has seen a loss and decline in a lot of different industry, whether it be automotive, whether it be steel and aluminum and manufacturing jobs, and that's something that was brought up by Ohio over the weekend on Sunday. She talked about the need to bring back those manufacturing jobs, the need to invest in infrastructure, and the need to invest in renewable energy and jobs that are really appealing for export around the world. And this is something that really does resonate with voters here in Ohio. Of course, the polls here in Columbus, in Ohio, they close at 7:30 this evening, Eastern time, and we'll be keeping a very close watch on those numbers so that we can bring you the very latest from the ground here in Columbus, Ohio. Back to you in studio.
Thanks. That was Manuel Rapallo reporting from Columbus, Ohio. Now to Marina Portnaya in Miami, where it could be another long night counting votes in this must-win state.
Decision day is here, and in the battleground state of Florida, officials are expecting record voter turnout. Now, all eyes are on the Sunshine State because it is a must-win for Donald Trump in order for the Republican nominee to secure a path to the White House. But Hillary Clinton does know that every vote in this state matters, and she's been pouring a lot of money and effort into Florida to register people and make sure that people turn out to vote. Back in 2012, President Barack Obama won Florida by a mere 74,000 votes. under 1% of victory margin. So right now, everybody knows that this swing state, which is a microcosm essentially of America, is an important factor in who wins this presidential election. You have 38% of voters in Florida that are registered Democrats, 36 that are registered Republicans, and the rest are either independent or affiliated with another party or no party at all. And those are the votes to be looking out for and to be watching, because during the primaries, independents and third-party voters were not allowed to cast a ballot. Now, prior to Election Day, a record 6.4 million Floridians cast ballots during early voting, and nearly 1 million of those voters are Puerto Ricans. That is what has been called Hillary Clinton's secret weapon. The amount of Puerto Rican registered voters in Florida that have been going to the polls and supporting her. We visited two Miami polling sites and spoke to voters, asking them who they are supporting on this election day.
It's the character of the Republican candidate that is running for president that I absolutely, all politics aside, which a lot of his stances I do not agree with, it's the human being that appalls me.
I voted today for Hillary Clinton. Why? Because I remember her husband being in presidency, and something that stood out to me, being someone much younger back then, the way they embraced minorities.
I voted for Hillary. Believe it or not. It's hard for me to even say that, but I had to. I had to pick the better of the two evils. I feel that her history, she has made mistakes and there is credibility issues, but I think there's more credibility issues on his side. And at least she's been doing things for the last 20 to 25 years that, although have not proven successful, I also feel that Congress plays a role in that.
I would have preferred someone like Bernie, but we had to pick these two.
Once we clean up our debt, it'll get better, you know?
That's the stuff Trump is talking about.
Yeah, that's what we, hey, I feel Trump on that, but all the other stuff, like, you know, I ain't with it.
Now, we should mention, just because we ran into only Clinton supporters doesn't guarantee that she will take the state. The candidates are essentially neck and neck in Florida, with Clinton leading by just 1 point. During the Florida primary, Donald Trump won 65 out of 66 counties. When the Republican presidential nominee comes to the Sunshine State, tens of thousands of people line up to hear him speak. So no matter which way you slice it, how Florida votes in this election on this day will be a major determinant in who wins the White House. Reporting from Miami, Marina Portnaya, RT.
That's right. Let's go to the outsiders now. Libertarian presidential nominee Governor Gary Johnson will watch the results from his home state of New Mexico. RT's Alexi Yaroshevsky is right there with them. Alexi, what's happening on the ground?
Well, we witnessed voting early in the morning here in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I can't say there were long lines into the polling stations, but the flow of voters never ceased, and it seems that people are genuinely excited about this very important choice. And in fact, in terms of New Mexico, it could be a very interesting race this time. It's been a traditionally blue state. In fact, in the last six presidential elections, five of them were comfortably won by the Democrats. Barack Obama won here by 10% just 4 years ago, and 8 years ago, he won by 15%. This time, however, the latest polls released on Monday by nonpartisan organizations suggest that the race is very tight, that Hillary Clinton is only in the lead by 1 to 2%. It is interesting to see whether the crossover vote, meaning Democrats voting for Donald Trump, which is a phenomenon here in New Mexico, could swing the state into his favor. It provides only five electoral votes, but there's no such thing as only five electoral votes in this campaign, it seems. And it's also a stomping ground for Gary Johnson. He used to be the governor of New Mexico, received a lot of praise for his work here, but so far his polls are not doing too good. In fact, there are concerns that he could make it over the 10% barrier in the state of New Mexico. Who is Gary Johnson? Take a look at my report.
Who the hell is Gary Johnson?
The question not many in America have an answer to, but nonetheless, between 4 and 7% of voters see the former New Mexico governor as the man to lead the country. Self-made millionaire, starting off a construction company to owning the Nevada-based marijuana firm, and yes, he is a long-term proponent of pot legalization. Previously a Republican, now a staunch libertarian, Gary Johnson is making a second attempt at the country's top job. In 2012, he garnered 1.2 million votes, the highest number by any third-party candidate in 40 years. His policies have not changed in 4 years, revolving around civil liberties and, the cornerstone of his domestic platform, debt elimination and low taxes. Something he had a tremendous success with while governing New Mexico.
Look, it takes Congress to go along with cutting spending, and I do believe that we should balance the federal budget. I think the consequences of a $20 trillion debt, and that will be the debt that we will have when Obama leaves office, is going to be irreparable.
Johnson has also been an avid fighter against what he calls unjust election system.
We have sued the Presidential Debate Commission. The contention is that if you're on the ballot in enough states to mathematically be elected president, that you should be included in the general election debates.
Gary Johnson's campaign also had its dark moments.
What would you do if you were elected about Aleppo?
About
Aleppo.
And what is Aleppo?
However, despite that setback, Gary Johnson has always had a very clear view on how to combat terrorism.
We need to cut off funding to these groups which ultimately make this possible. And we can do that. We can do this with our brains. This is a cyber war. I think our military interventions are making things worse, not better.
Gary Johnson's domestic and foreign policies may seem vague to some, but there's no denying the one aspect where the libertarian candidate is well ahead of his rivals is his sense of humor.
I think I could stand up there for the whole debate and not say anything.
You have a 1 in 5, a higher chance of having a heart attack within the first hour if you smoke marijuana. There are legitimate side effects of this drug. The THC, when in the 60s, you know, I think the governor has had great fun with his humor, but this isn't a funny.
Well, Governor Gary Johnson, as you can see, is a man of humor. He also known to have climbed the Mount Everest. Climbing the mountain of the two-party system has been a harder task so far, but we'll see whether tonight here in Albuquerque he'll have a reason to celebrate and whether New Mexico would become a swing state or a toss-up.
Lexi Yaroshevsky, live in New Mexico for us. Let's go live now to Governor Gary Johnson, Libertarian candidate for president, joining us now.
Hi, Gary. Governor Jesse Ventura here. How are you doing? You must be exhausted. I've been through a few of these races where you're out talking 24/7. How do you feel to finally know that today it'll end one way or the other?
Well, it's great to be on the way down from the top of the mountain. And top of the mountain, hey, we did finish this race. And I'm believing, Jesse, that and you've done the same in your career, is giving people a third choice here, in this case, one they could be proud of, you know, the whole honesty, integrity. You gotta live with yourself 2 days after this election, 2 months after this election, 2 years after this election.
Now, Gary, you know, when Trump talks about a rigged election, he's correct. The election is rigged, but it's not rigged in the manner that he means. It's rigged to stop anyone like you or a Jill Stein from being able to play on a level playing field and actually compete to win. Because I remember in Minnesota, I couldn't have debated. I was polling 9% at Labor Day, but I was allowed in the debates. And 60 days later, I was the governor of Minnesota, proving that it could be done. But you've got to get into the debates. What are we going to do to get a third or fourth choice on those debates?
You know, Jesse, first of all, you hit it right on the head. You can't, look, if you're not in the Super Bowl of politics, in this case, the general election debates, how do you compete? And there needs to be a cutoff, because there's 1,000 people that register with the Federal Elections Commission to run for president. How about the cutoff that if you're on the ballot in all 50 states, that you should be in the general election debates? I hope if nothing else comes of this election, that people recognize that the Presidential Debate Commission wears no clothes. This is not fair. When 50% of Americans right now, when they go to register to vote, are saying that they are independent, where is that representation? There needs to be a cutoff, but cutoff on the ballot in all 50 states, I think that's a logical place to start. And it's a chicken and egg thing. Ross Perot was polling lower than I was at the time of the first debate this cycle. And he was allowed in the debates because both Bush and Clinton saw it to their advantage for him to be in the debates.
Yeah, and what did, as a result of the debates, Ross Perot got 20% of the vote, 1 out of 5. And they were sure. I'm glad the governor brought that up, because that what happened then was in 96, it's terrified them so badly that Perot got 1 out of 5 votes that he was cut out in 96. He wasn't allowed to debate. Now, how do you cut out someone who got 1 out of 5 votes the very previous election?
Well, the two parties in your state thought it was going to go to their advantage to bring you in, and it completely backfired.
Yep,
I mean, what
exactly
was that like?
And the thing is that Perot, what happened was Clinton and Dole, prior to that, it was the National League of Women Voters that
exactly
ran the federal debates. Well, they took it away then and formed the Federal Debate Commission, which the heads of it were both Democrats and Republicans. So essentially, they allow these two parties to determine who is going to be in the debates. And of course, the two parties aren't going to let a third entity in there. They might get beat.
Well, and not only that, it was the, I believe it was the 88 election when that started, and it really changed. Gary, I want to ask you about ranked voting. Maine is voting on passing a ranked voting system this election. I think it would take effect in 2018. What do you think about that? It's already used in San Francisco, Cambridge, Massachusetts. You rank your votes 1 through 3, first, second, third. What do you think about that?
Oh, I think it's a great idea. I think it does give third parties a chance. And, you know, I realize that the, you know, the campaign's over with, but getting back to this election, I really think that the libertarian animal is unique. Small government, all about being able to make personal choices, really skeptical regarding military interventions, regime change, and supportive of free markets, something that neither Trump or Clinton are. So just back to debates, being the third voice in the debate, so different than the other two, and what I think reflective of most Americans. But ranked voting, yeah, you know, I think that would offer an opportunity for more voices also.
What it would also do is it would take away an excuse that the Democrats and Republicans constantly use. Whoever loses this election will turn and blame the third parties.
The stolen votes, the wasted votes.
These are the votes. If they hadn't voted for these third party candidates, I would have won. Instead of accepting responsibility and realizing
what do you got,
Gary? You got beat. Go ahead, Gary.
Well, just that, you know, how about the notion that everyone that ends up voting for me today wouldn't have even gone to the polls and voted, offering people their first vote. And as I've said down the stretch here, you want to waste your vote for Clinton or Trump? Well, have at it, and nothing's going to change if you waste your vote on Trump or Clinton.
Well, and Gary, the thing is that all those votes will be counted, and they will tally the people who voted for you. Libertarian presidential candidate, Governor Gary Johnson, thank you very much for that, and good luck tonight.
Great to see you again, Gary.
Yeah, thank you both. Great being with you both. Thank you.
These third-party candidates have been trying to make inroads this year because the two candidates, one for the GOP and the Democratic side, are the most unpopular candidates who've ever run. We've talked about that. Now, both are expecting to win, though. And we have live coverage from both their camps with Watching the Hawks co-host Tabitha Wallace. And at the Clinton camp, she's at the Clinton camp. Tyrell Ventura is at the Trump party. Very brave of him there. Tyrell, what's going on with you at the Trump camp?
Well, we are here at the Trump camp. Donald is getting a little sleepy. He was up late, still campaigning deep into the night. He got a little bad news this morning, I believe, as the judge rejected Trump's lawsuit against the Nevada Registrar of Voters in Clark County. He was saying that the polling stations being allowed to stay open late may have given the Democrats an advantage, but he's behind me right now at the Midtown Manhattan Hilton in the city that never sleeps, so he's going to be waiting on pins and needles to see how he ends up tonight. He did vote this morning at about 11 a.m., and there was some scattered boos here in his home of New York City, so we'll have to see if those boos carry over to a big loss for Trump tonight, or if at the end of the day there'll be celebrations behind me here at the Midtown Hilton in the Big Apple.
Jesse, what do you got to say to your son on that one?
Well, not a whole lot. It's just good to see him again. I'd rather see him in person rather than the camera, but it's nice to see he's out doing his job, and he's at the Trump headquarters, and if he gets a chance to say hi to Donald, I hope he'll do that for me, because I didn't vote for Donald Trump, but I still consider Donald Trump a friend of nearly 25 years.
Well, Tyrell, I'll tell you what.
Well, Jesse, I would love...
Keep on going.
Jesse, I would love to say hi to Donald, but they're not allowing international press into Trump headquarters tonight, which is an odd choice.
Yeah.
Well, are they allowing United States press can get in, but international cannot?
Oh, yes, they are.
Very convenient.
Oh, yes, they are. But international, they excluded.
Of course. Well, hey, if you any shenanigans, well, duck for cover.
Wait, I got a question. Why is international excluded?
They got no reason. They got...
No publishable reason.
No reason. Maybe it's
this election doesn't.
Maybe it's the idea of, you know. Well,
okay, guys, we got to go.
This election
isolationism
doesn't affect just the United States. It affects the world.
Oh, they don't want to talk about that.
It's
ridiculous. All right. Hey, listen, we got a nice young lady we got to head over to. Thanks for that, Tyrell, New York City, following the Trump campaign. Brave man there. And, of course, bringing us the play-by-play from Clinton, that good old watch party. Watching the Hawks host, Tabitha Wallace. My lady, you are ready and waiting. What is going on there?
Well, we're here at the Javits Center in New York City, also just a couple of miles from Tyrell, and we're here under an actual, little on the nose, glass ceiling. And the Clinton camp, everyone here, their staff, lots of Secret Service and press have been here all night, or at least right at dawn, getting ready for what could be one of the most historic nights, not just for her, but for women, for politics in general. And we're here to find out all about that and see what they're all feeling. It's still a little sparse here right now, but it'll get a little more crazy as the night goes on. Most importantly, this morning, Hillary Clinton voted. It was a pretty big deal. A lot of women were going out to vote in white to support the suffragists, sort of give their nod to the women who made it possible. And Hillary Clinton, when she went out to vote in Chappaqua, New York, actually had this to say about what it felt like to vote for herself in a presidential election.
It's the most humbling feeling, Dan, because, you know, I know how much responsibility goes with this, and so many people are counting on the outcome of this election, what it means for our country, and I'll do the very best I can if I'm fortunate enough to win today.
Tabitha, has there ever been a candidate that didn't vote for themselves?
I don't know. I don't know that we've ever known somebody who has done it.
Where they've come out and said, well, you know, I had kind of second thoughts when I got in the booth, and so I actually voted for my opponent.
Come on, I would. Wouldn't you?
I think there's a few that maybe should have. Yeah.
So
I'd write you in, Jesse, if I was running.
Tabitha, what's the general feeling you're getting there on the ground? Are they positive? Is there a feeling that Hillary Clinton is going to win? Or are they skeptical? Do they think Trump could upset her?
Well, I think no one's counting counting any chickens, any eggs, any baskets, nothing until they start to get hashed, until real numbers start coming in. But it's positive here. That was in a lot of really good, positive energy here. Everyone is kind of just ready to get it going.
Thanks, Tabitha. Hey, we're going to be checking in with you later. We hear she's got a huge fireworks display if she wins. Can't wait to see that one. Thanks, Tabitha Wallace out of New York City following the Clinton campaign. Excuse me. Can I just say something?
Sure, absolutely.
Did you hear that she has got the fire department's on standby for her celebratory fireworks. Does that seem a little bit...
I don't know.
It's huge.
I guess it's not when you look at that, the astounding number of $1.2 billion spent.
That's what I'm saying. Can you imagine how much you spent on this?
Well, when you got that kind of money to play with, I guess you can have a big fireworks display at the end. You know, you're not paying for it.
Well,
Special interest is.
Well, exactly. It's not just, you know, fireworks. I mean, you know, have a sparkler or two. It's the price. I mean, I want to find out how much money she dumped into that. Hey, maybe it came from the Clinton Foundation. But really, it's time to do some math, everybody. We have got to break down the numbers with the math expert tonight on the states and the polls. Simone Del Rosario, what do you got for us?
All right. Well, I wanted to start by taking a look at some of the previous elections. We can find out how people have voted in the past and how it would affect us today. We're going to start with the Gore v. Bush matchup of 2000. where the winner of the presidency did not win the popular vote. George W. Bush took several key states that Clinton had actually won, southern states, in 1996. And then he beat Gore, of course, by winning the all-important states of Ohio and Florida. That put him at 271, just eking out a victory. Remember, you have to reach 270 to win. Now, even though Gore did lose the presidency, you can see he actually received about 500,000 more votes than Bush. This was only the fourth time in American history that that had happened. So let's break down who voted for whom. Now, Bush lost the woman vote, expected, but he won the male vote by 54%. Gore won minority vote by significant margins, but Bush dominated the white vote here. He won 55% of white voters to Gore's 42. It's a huge margin considering that 81% of those who went to the polls in the year 2000, they were white. Now, age, not a factor this year. The candidates basically split every single age group there. And then in 2004, Bush won his reelection campaign against our current Secretary of State John Kerry, which is going to bring us now to 2008, the matchup between current U.S. President Barack Obama and Arizona Senator John McCain. There were some huge changes to our map in 2008. States that were once considered Republican strongholds, like Virginia, like North Carolina, like Indiana, those flipped blue, went for Obama. He also took back crucial battleground states, Iowa, Florida, Ohio, and then he got some more in the West. He took on Nevada, Colorado, and New Mexico here. The result, of course, he dominated the Electoral College, 365 to 173. He also beat McCain in the popular vote by nearly 10 million votes, and this is how he did it. Obama continued the Democratic tradition of winning women, but then he did the unthinkable. He actually won the male vote over there by 1 point, something that had not been done in more than 50 years. McCain still won white voters of 55 to 43, but this time around, whites just made up 74% of voters compared with 81% 8 years ago. See a trend here, more minorities going out to vote. Obama, of course, dominating the minority vote, particularly African Americans, 95% of the vote there. But here's where he did most of his damage. He mobilized the youth vote. They turned out in huge numbers for him. He took two-thirds of the 18 to 29-year-olds. In 2012, Obama ran for re-election against former governor of Massachusetts, Mitt Romney. He held on to nearly every state he won in 2008, only losing North Carolina and Indiana to Romney. That brings us to today. And this is what our projected electoral map looks like. Remember, the magic number here is 270. We've identified 16 states in the District of Columbia that will almost certainly vote for Hillary Clinton. Those are the ones here in blue. That's worth 201 electoral votes over there. We think that there are 21 reliably Republican states in red that will most certainly vote for Donald Trump. That'll take him to 164. So Trump already at a huge disadvantage here. This election is really going to come down to the 13 states here we see in gray. Based on current polling, we expect Clinton to pick up Colorado, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and Virginia. That would get her to 269 electoral votes. That's just one shy of our magic number. So she would need to pick up any one of these remaining gray states to win the presidency. Even if Trump wins all of these gray states we still have left on our map, the best that they could do is tie over here at 269, the tiebreaker going to the House of Representatives. But if Trump manages to flip, say, Pennsylvania, turn that one blue, his way, the map gets interesting here. In this scenario, his path to the presidency includes not only taking Pennsylvania, but he's going to have to take Arizona over here. He'll also have to get Ohio, North Carolina, and Florida, and Georgia, where a southern state may not go his way. That would give him 273 electoral votes. That's one path to presidency here. Lindsey and Jesse, the key battleground states we're going to be looking at tonight are in Pennsylvania, Ohio, Florida. That's because those are worth a whopping 67 electoral votes. Clinton definitely has the easier path to the presidency here tonight. Trump's chances are hinged on the polling that we have being very wrong, which is possible, or the minority turnout being lower than expected, because as you guys saw, that would help a Clinton victory.
Gosh, you know, the weirder things have happened, and thank you very much for going over the history and the trends there. It's definitely good to know that stuff, and it's stuff a lot of us forget. Thanks, Simone Del Rosario with the numbers tonight. And of course, keeping with third parties this evening, Green Party nominee Jill Stein will be watching the results on the Lower East Side of New York City, because that's her style. The aim for the Greens is to get to that all-important 5% of the national vote to keep their momentum going into the future. RT correspondent Trinity Chavez is with the Stein campaign. Trinity, what's happening?
So we're here at Aventina restaurant here on the Lower East Side in New York City, where we are anticipating the celebration of Jill Stein's campaign party that will be taking place during this long-awaited election. People from all over the country are finally going to cast their vote to decide who they want to be the next president of the United States. Now, although the two major party candidates only want you to believe that there are only two choices in this presidential election, that is simply not the case. Second and third party candidates are getting noticed this time around, even Green Party presidential nominee Jill Stein. So let's take a look to see exactly who Jill Stein really is. Activist, doctor, and lead singer of a 90s folk band. And now, Jill Stein wants to be the next president of the United States. The 66-year-old Massachusetts doctor and Green Party candidate is making her second run for the White House since 2012. Dr. Jill Stein is offering an aggressive set of policy prescriptions in her long shot bid. But what makes her different?
Well, let me count the ways.
Popular among the millennials and former Bernie Sanders supporters, Stein's mainstream platform issues include the fight for a $15 minimum wage increase, alleviate millions of people from student debt, and the Harvard-trained doctor believes that a foreign policy based on diplomacy is necessary to end conflicts that may lead the U.S. to nuclear war. She calls them real solutions, something she says is lacking from other presidential candidates. And Stein wants Americans to decide the future for the United States, not a political establishment.
My hope is to help inform and empower the American people to actually make choices, informed choices about our future. That's what democracy is supposed to be about. Voters are being intimidated into voting for the candidates that are the most disliked and untrusted in our history of presidential races. And it seems with every passing day, the race becomes more scandal-ridden and more outrageous between the queen of corruption, Hillary Clinton, and the walking scandal sexual predator, Donald Trump.
With Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton constantly sparking controversy in mainstream media, it's no wonder why only one out of four Americans know about Stein's campaign. Despite the fact that many Americans don't like the two major party candidates, national polls show that Stein is in the very, very low single digits, barely making a footnote in the election coverage by mainstream media, an effect of what she calls a biased two-party system.
The polling that's out there is very biased. It systematically undercounts young voters, millennials, people of color, people who are not likely voters, that is, who are not enfranchised by the system.
Yes, so Jill Stein is doing whatever it takes to get her voice heard. Now, all those Stein supporters, you know, have come to terms with the fact that she may not be president this time around. Stein's goal is to try to obtain 5% of the national vote, which would get her millions of dollars in federal funding to run for president in 2020.
Trinity Chavez there in New York for us. Thank you so much. It's been a rough year for Bernie Sanders. He emerged as a dark horse, as a relative unknown, even though he was in the Senate for decades and still is. Like Johnson, he attacks from the outside. An independent senator, but a Democratic presidential candidate. He spoke straight and people responded.
That's what this campaign is about. Welcome to the political revolution. Thank you all. The greed, recklessness, and illegal behavior on Wall Street nearly destroyed the American and global economy. The only way to contain the street's excess is with reforms so big, bold, and public they can't be watered down. I
I believe that today it is absolutely appropriate to impose a tax on Wall Street speculation.
We also have to keep our eye on Wall Street. We can't ever let it wreck Main Street again.
I am endorsing Hillary Clinton.
Very interesting person there. Let's go to two more guys operating from the outside and looking for victories. Let's go to Green Party Vice Presidential Candidate Ajami Baraka and Arvind Vora, Vice Chairman of the Libertarian National Committee. Ajami, I want to start with you. Over the last few days, it's been a frenzy. What's it been like on the inside of the campaign, fighting the huge amount of mainstream coverage of the large parties, but still fighting for that 5% of the national vote?
Well, it's been a good experience. We are fighting, as you say, for every vote. We are here to win, and we are getting the kind of energy that we need from our supporters. They're telling us go forward, and that's what we've done for the last few months to represent them, represent their interests, represent their hopes for the future. So, it's been tough. But you know, we know that we are, in fact, the wave of the future. So it's been good, also.
Jesse, I know you wanted to weigh in on.
Well, you know, for me, again, it's the battle that's going to take place always. It's the same thing. How do we get a third or fourth voice in the election, and what has to be required to do so?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it all comes down to. Because as I stated before, I was polling 9% at Labor Day. I was allowed in the debates, and I proved you could win. In 60 days, you could go from single digit and win the election. Well, these two parties are not, they learned from that. They're not going to let that happen again. They're not going to let anyone debate. And I'm outraged over the fact, and I'll call them the lemmings of America, who sit back and accept this when polls state that 40% of the people, quote, are independents. Well, that means if you split the other 60 to 30-30, roughly, for Dems and Repubs, you got the majority of people out there not banding together to vote for someone other than what these two minorities want.
And not only that, just to point out, as you were saying with independent voters, an astonishing amount of them are under the age of 40. These people are the ones paying off student loans and raising families. And Arvind, I want to talk to you about that with the actions of the Libertarian Party after this, and also going to the down ballot candidates, of which you are going to be a part of. What do you face? What's the plan? Because you have a huge amount of young people that this party has got to capture.
What so many independent voters want is less government. And that means they want to see an end to the war on drugs so that drug businesses can settle disputes without violence. They want to see Americans bringing their troops back home from overseas, shutting down foreign military bases so that we can be safer, not creating enemies around the world. They want to see the government out of the bedroom and out of businesses so that we can create jobs. They want to see an end or a reduction to the income tax so we can attract businesses and the job creators from all over the world. That's what they want to see. And we need to bring that message to them. Gary Johnson has done so much to bring that message, but to really bring that message, we need to end this rigged debate system that prevents that message from landing.
Even down ballot. Jesse, what do you have to say?
It's a situation now. You heard Hillary Clinton talk about rebuilding our infrastructure and doing all these internal things to help our country. How are we going to pay for it when we're halfway around the world draining $1 trillion into an unwinnable war, mm-hmm. or multiple unwinnable wars over there? It's time to cease supporting the military-industrial complex and start supporting the redevelopment of our own country. I've always believed you take care of your own backyard first before you venture into anybody else's yard.
There's absolutely no justification for the kind of nation building that we're seeing. There's no moral justification, and there's no financial justification. But also, if we end that, think about the jobs and the skill we're bringing home from overseas. We're bringing home money, but we're also bringing home some of the most dedicated, hardworking people in the entire world. I'm referring to, of course, the American troops. These are people who could be leading that economic growth and economic change. People could be creating jobs and making such an amazing difference.
What angers me is I'm a Vietnam veteran, and I come from the era of Vietnam. We're in charge now. Mm. How could we get fooled again,
exactly.
To quote the Who? We don't get fooled again. Well, we got fooled again. Mm-hmm. Well, it happened because who was in charge? A couple of draft dodgers didn't experience Vietnam. Mm-hmm. So they had no idea when they went over to the Middle East, they were getting into a quagmire. No one's going to win over there. It's worse today than it was before we left.
Well, let's talk to Ojama about this. What do you think about this generation of, as you said, the baby boomers, the Vietnam generation, letting the younger generation down? Arvin's pointing out that we need less government. How, you know, he's going to fight against a generation that's used to being more taken care of. You're fighting a different end of the battle that government can help. How do you speak to a younger generation coming from a Vietnam generation?
Well, you know, we have an honest conversation. We say that many of us who have been involved in this struggle for decades, we made a real valiant effort. And I think we laid a foundation for the kind of movements that we see emerging today. Real movements that are committed to real social justice. Movements that understand that we just can't look at what is unfolding here in this country in terms of domestic politics and economics. But we have to look at the role that the U.S. plays globally. And understand that we have a responsibility for a U.S. foreign policy that results in death and destruction around the world. And so, In that conversation with young people, we are seeing a real response, a real positive response. You know, our main base of support is, in fact, with young folks. And they are concerned not only about the permanent war agenda that seems to be the agenda of both parties, but they're also concerned about issues of basic social justice. They don't believe that, you know, you can just remove the state and the magic of the market takes care of all of our problems. They're concerned about this reckless conversation around eliminating Social Security, a program that came out of a very progressive moment and struggle on the part of working class people.
Well, we've got...
They don't believe...
Exactly.
They don't believe that...
A libertarian here shaking his head. Unfortunately, we've got to go, but it's interesting to see two third-party representatives talking about tackling the same issue, which is getting onto the stage and playing on that field. Sorry, we've got to go right now. Well, would you like to talk here?
Well,
sorry.
One little thing. When I was governor, I tried to bring all the third parties together, and I found the common denominator, the dirty money. But you can't bring them together. It's like herding cats. They run everywhere. They all got their agendas, and that's how Hillary and the Republicans and Democrats survive.
Well, yeah, but they can only survive because of that big government in the first place. And we take that away, there's no way for them to bring their forces upon us.
All right. Thank you very much, you guys. Thanks for this discussion. Green Party Vice Presidential Candidate Ojama Baraka and Arvin Vora, Vice Chairman of the Libertarian National Committee. Thank you both.
Thank you.
To the West Coast now, where California, Oregon, and Washington will most likely go to Hillary Clinton. But there are some Western states up in the air, as well as some key Senate races to pay attention to. RT's Brigida Santos talked with California voters today. Take a look.
As you can see, no lines here in Los Angeles, where things are moving very quickly. While there is a steady stream of people going in and out, it's pretty short because California isn't really known for its long lines. But people here today in California will be determining not only who they want to see in the White House, but also the fate of the 17 propositions on this year's ballot. With so many options to choose from, the Secretary of State's office did its best to try and inform voters ahead of today by mailing out millions of copies of this handy voter guide. But as you can see, this is pretty big. It's about 220 pages long, and it would take the average reader two entire workdays to consume. All of this has led to a little bit of confusion at the polls, except for where the president is concerned. Most people in California are voting for Hillary Clinton, which is unsurprising as the state has been voting blue since 1988.
Voting for Hillary Clinton because she just represents everything that I want this country to experience.
I think our government is so corrupt, and he's not a politician. He talks from the bottom of his heart, and that's why I voted for Trump.
America has an issue either way with either of the candidates. One, because Hillary is, I mean, like, Donald Trump is very extreme. I don't like a lot of his policies. I don't like a lot of Hillary's policies. I don't like the way that she presents herself. I don't like the way that he presents himself either. They both have a terrible past. One of them is in politics, and one of them is just entertainment, who he is as a person. I feel like she's more dangerous in a way.
Today, Californians will also be deciding who they want to replace retiring U.S. Senator Barbara Boxer. Right now, State Attorney General Kamala Harris is in the lead over U.S. Representative Loretta Sanchez. Both women are Democrats, making this the first year in state history for a Republican to be left off the Senate race in a general election. And that has to do with new state primary rules that had advanced the top two candidates to the general election, regardless of party. Parties aside, all of these voters seem to agree on one thing. They can't wait for this election to be over. Reporting from Los Angeles, Brigida Santos, RT.
Isn't that the truth? Coming up after this break, we've got to look back at the history of third parties. Stay with us.
You are watching Election 2016 Worldwide on RT.
People have got to know whether or not their president's a crook.
American people deserve to know
what
answers.
What difference at this point does it make?
We must guard against the military-industrial complex.
The Cold War is over.
We shall never negotiate.
An American airplane dropped one bomb on Hiroshima.
To know war is to know that there is still madness. Yet, we do what we must.
The only thing we have to fear is...
I am officially
one. The future doesn't belong to the faint-hearted.
This is Boombas, and these are the stories we are tracking for you today.
I think that the euro is severely undervalued.
That's the highest output in over 3 years.
What the Fed really wants is inflation.
The U.S. has more than doubled imports from Iraq.
All that debt that was accumulated, they have to pay it off.
And when you see oil go down, our economy goes down.
What do you make of that data, and what does it really mean for the average worker?
For decades, the American middle class has been railroaded by Washington politics. Big money corporate interests has drowned out a lot of voices. That's how it is in the news culture in this country now. That's where I come in. I'm Ed Schultz. I do the news on RT America. I'll make sure you don't get railroaded, and you'll get the straight talk and the straight news. Question more.
Hi, my name is Manuel Rapalo. RT, it's just smarter.
Welcome back to Election 2016 Worldwide, hosted by Jesse Ventura and Lindsay Franks.
Well, welcome back. Thanks to the Electoral College system, some states have much more power than others in deciding the next president of the United States. Wouldn't you know it? For a look at just a few of these battleground states, as they're called, let's go to RT's Simone Del Rosario. Simone, you got a whole thing set up to break it down for us. Give it to us.
All right, right. This is our projected electoral map as it stands before any voting is even done. Now, based on our current polls, we predict that from these blue states, Hillary Clinton is going to pick up 201 electoral votes. From the states colored red, we think Trump is going to get 164 electoral votes. So that leaves 13 battleground states here, which will decide this election tonight. Let's focus on five of the most important ones. We're going to start here with Florida. Now, ever since 2000, Florida has been notorious for playing an outsized role in presidential elections. With 29 electoral votes, Florida is a must-win for Trump. Right now, Real Clear Politics has Trump, or has Clinton, sorry, with a 1.2% lead in the state. Actually, if I do my math right, that's a 0.2% difference right there. So Trump is leading it right there. Hispanic voters, key in Florida, they make up 23% of the state's population. In the past, Republicans have done well in the state because of older, traditionally conservative Cuban and Puerto Rican communities. But those communities are getting younger and more liberal, and with Trump's more controversial immigration stance, Hispanic community may be far more reluctant to support the Republican nominee this time around. Let's go over to Ohio now. 18 electoral votes. Amazingly, no Republican has ever won the presidency without winning Ohio. And only two Democrats have won the presidency without it. Right now, Trump has a 3.3% lead in the state, despite being in the middle of the country. Ohio is as diverse, and it's a good representation of the U.S. as a whole. Now, there's a large population of blue-collar workers, millennials, and African-Americans that traditionally support the Democratic ticket, and also a large population of suburban white voters that traditionally support Republicans. So the battle here is over the coveted independents, which represent about a third of the state. Whoever wins this group will likely win Ohio. Now to Arizona, perhaps the most surprising swing state in this election. The state has 11 electoral votes, and with the exception of Bill Clinton in 1996, it voted Republican for more than 60 years. Today, Real Clear Politics has Trump with a 4-point lead, but Clinton was leading the state up until a week ago. If Clinton can manage a stunning victory in Arizona, it'll make Trump's task of getting to 270 exponentially harder. The Hispanic population has grown by a stunning 53% in the state since 2000. That alone might be enough for Clinton to pull off an upset there. Let's head back to the Midwest now in the bellwether state of Iowa. It's only worth 6 electoral votes, but if the matchup tonight is close, Iowa could play an important role. Right now, Trump has a 2.4% lead in Iowa. For most of the 70s and 80s, Iowa was a Republican state, but since 1988, the Democratic candidate has won Iowa all but one time, albeit by close margins. It's a close race this year, and if Trump can win the state, our takeaway is that his rhetoric on jobs and trade is resonating with working-class Midwest voters. Finally, North Carolina. 15 electoral votes up for grabs in this state. Like the rest of the South, North Carolina is traditionally red. Republicans won 7 in a row up until 2008, when Obama flipped it blue. Right now, Trump is barely up with a 0.8% advantage, way below any margin of error we're going to see. If he loses North Carolina to Clinton, I'm not going to lie, it's going to be very difficult for him to win this election without it, given his limited paths to 270. Of course, the candidates are also battling it out. Colorado, New Hampshire, Georgia, Pennsylvania, Michigan, Virginia, Nevada, Wisconsin. Lindsay, Jesse, we're going to be keeping a close eye on all of these 13 battleground states as the night goes on and on and on.
This is just some pretty shocking numbers there, I've got to admit. Thanks for that, Simone. Well, this election saw the Libertarian and Green parties emerge as the top third-party choices. At one point, accounting for nearly 15% in the polls. Later on, Libertarian presidential nominee Governor Gary Johnson will weigh in with his take on the struggle of third parties to emerge into the mainstream. For now, RT's Ryan Kerr gives us a look back at the colorful history of third parties in the United States.
What does the term third party mean to you? By definition, third parties are just that, the third most popular party on the ballot. Today's major third parties, the Libertarians under Gary Johnson.
The Presidential Debate Commission is made up of Democrats and Republicans, and they do whatever it takes to exclude everyone else.
And the Greens, led by Jill Stein.
It's very hard as a Green when you don't have corporate money behind you. We do not accept corporate money. We're the one party that's not poisoned by it.
Face a steep uphill climb if they want to seriously challenge for the White House. That's because third parties are outsiders, rendered irrelevant by the corporate duopoly and shut out of the presidential debates. But this wasn't always the case. For the first 70 years of our history, there wasn't a concept of a third party. That's because outsider parties actually had a chance for success. George Washington ran unaffiliated but had strong support from the Federalists, who were opposed by the Democratic Republicans of Jefferson and Madison. These Democratic Republicans became the modern Democrats in 1828 under Andrew Jackson, challenged first by the National Republicans in the 1820s and 30s, running received roughly 8% of the vote, and later merged with the National Republicans into the Whig Party. The Whigs gave way in 1856 to the Republicans, and with that shift, the electoral makeup of the two-party system in the United States was set.
What you had in the early days of the Republic were, there were always basically two giants, whatever you wanted to call, you know, their names, whatever, Federalists or Republicans or Anti-Federalists and Federalists, you know, whatever you wanted to call them. There were always factions in each that would break off, move, try to, you know, exist independently, and then join up with another faction.
Since the formation of the Republican Party in 1856, Democrats and Republicans have dominated the U.S. political landscape, holding the White House with only occasional blips of resistance from third parties. These blips came most notably in 1912 with the Bull Moose Party, aka the Progressive Party, which sponsored President Teddy Roosevelt, or the consistent popularity of the Socialist Party under Eugene Debs in the early teens and 1920 election. In the 1948 election, Strom Thurmond's States' Rights Party, known as the Dixiecrats, took 39 electoral votes.
In the words of John Paul Jones, We have just begun to fight.
George Wallace's American Independent Party was the last third party to take electoral votes in an election, collecting 46 in 1968.
There have been many movements in our country of a new party nature in the last decade or so and the last 50 years. But no new party movement has ever had the grassroots support that our movement has.
Ross Perot's Reform Party run in 1992 and 1996 was the closest modern-day third-party challenge.
I was not put on the ballot by either of the two parties. I was not put on the ballot by any PAC money, by any foreign lobbyist money, by any special interest money. This is a movement that came from the people. This is the way the framers of the Constitution intended our government to be, a government that comes from the people.
And many say that Ralph Nader spoiled Al Gore's chances in 2000.
If we exceed expectations, then the impact of this movement is going to be even greater than we ever thought after Election Day.
Our revolution continues.
Today, the movement behind Bernie Sanders, consolidating young and disenfranchised voters, tired of what they call a broken system, points to a future where American political discontent may boil over with third parties emerging into the mainstream.
Unless there is there was a crisis, a constitutional crisis, just like the Civil War, something along those lines, I don't see a third party coalescing, but then also having the strength to really push the others aside or have this, you know, gather unto it all of these different factions and groups. But it might be big enough to you know, tip the balance and make history.
Perhaps not in this election or even the next, but future historians may look back on this time as the beginning of the end of two-party dominance in U.S. politics.
Host Ryan Kerfor is here in Washington. We'll be back in just a moment. In our next hour, we're going to talk to Dr. Ron Paul, who knows all too well what it's like to be snubbed by the mainstream media. Stay with us.
Who's going to be the 45th president of the United States? Stay tuned to Election 2016 Worldwide on RT.
You're watching an RT America special report.
Man, it ain't about him. It's about you. It's about me. It's about everybody.
Basically, everything that you think you know about civil society had broken down.
There's always going to be somebody else one step ahead of the game.
We should not be in the business of normalizing violence.
We don't need people that think like this on our planet.
This is an incredibly tense situation.
On Contact, where neoliberalism is greed, where endless war is insanity, where patriotism is deception, where truth is not a casualty of war, where socialism is the counterweight to barbarism, where revolt is a moral imperative, where the crimes of empire are slaughter, where the crimes of Wall Street are theft, where the crimes of state are tyranny. On Contact with Chris Hedges, where I question more.
We do stand on the edge of a great new era.
What happened to the American century? What happened to America's ideal of progress?
It is a time for pathfinders and pioneers.
If you're an entrepreneur right now in America, the last thing you want to do is take risks.
You'll see that whole streets are just closing down.
It's beyond life.
Americans are finding themselves in a desperate situation.
Here we are, naked in front of the world. It's a real tragedy.
Welcome back to Election 2016 Worldwide, hosted by Jesse Ventura and Lindsey Franks.
Welcome back to Election Night 2016 on RT America. I'm Lindsey Franks. We have got worldwide coverage coming at you from Berlin to New York, New York over to the West Coast. We are picking apart the outsiders.
And I'm Governor Jesse Ventura. We're talking third parties. Those fighting to get into the mainstream of politics being shut out all the time because it's a rigged two-party system, and when you control it, you control who's in and out of it.
And you practically control a lot of the entire world in the process. Governor, it was a long shot for you when you ran for the top job in Minnesota. I want to talk about that. First, Manila Chan takes a look at how it all happened for you.
Back in 1998, on a cool early November evening, United States politics as usual was shaken to its very core. With a bright full moon shining down, the state of Minnesota shocked the world as they elected former Navy SEAL, professional wrestler, actor, and mayor Jesse Ventura to the office of governor. With 36% of the vote and almost 800,000 individual votes, Ventura beat the mayor of the capital city of St. Paul, Republican Norm Coleman, and Democrat Hubert Skip Humphrey III, Minnesota's sitting attorney general and the son of former vice president and legendary Democrat Hubert Humphrey. Running under Ross Perot's Reform Party banner, Ventura's grassroots campaign was truly just that, raising just $300,000 compared to the over $4 million spent by his two opponents. Ventura captivated Minnesotans on the campaign trail with his honesty, candor, passion, and showmanship.
New from the Reform Party.
Creative campaign ads featuring two kids playing with a Jesse Ventura action figure fighting evil special interest man and Ventura himself posing as Rodin's the Thinker entertained and educated Minnesota voters to his message of small government, cutting taxes, and putting the people over party politics. But what truly put the check mark next to Ventura's name on that fateful November night has to be one of the greatest election blunders in recent political history. Thinking that Ventura would take more votes from his Republican opponent Norm Coleman, Democrat Skip Humphrey refused to take part in the statewide televised debates unless Jesse was included. This proved to be fatal for both two-party candidates, as Jesse's honesty, showmanship, and ability to speak for the common man destroyed his two button-down, overly rehearsed political double-speaking opponents. The election of third-party candidate Jesse Ventura as governor of Minnesota truly was a political revolution, who many outsider candidates, including Jill Stein, Gary Johnson, and even Donald Trump, will be trying to emulate on this election day.
What does it make you think looking back at those videos?
I'll tell you, it brings back great memories, but let me state this, that would not have happened, and I'll repeat it, if the criteria today were used of 15%, I would not have been allowed in those debates, and therefore I would not have won. I proved that someone could be single digit and in 60 days win the election if you're given a level playing field. We're being cheated in the United States to that level playing field.
Exactly. It's something that needs to be talked about a lot more. We're going to do that here. Governor Ventura wasn't the only history-making third-party candidate in American politics. When talking about outside challenges, you always have to mention the man with the libertarian cult following, Dr. Ron Paul, who we have live with us now. Dr. Paul, thank you very much for joining us. I know you and Jesse have had a long relationship.
That is right, and good to talk with both of you, and good to say hello to Jesse.
Good morning, Dr. Paul, or good afternoon we are now. I've been up a long time today, but it's, you know, I'll tell you, it was wonderful joining forces with you. I'll never forget it. At that Republican National Convention in St. Paul, when you and I headed the counter convention at the Target Center in Minneapolis, sold out to the brink, to the rafters, and we had no more security than what's normally there at a Minnesota Timberwolf basketball game. And yet the Republican side, you'd think you were going into Beirut, Lebanon, into a war zone. Am I not right, Dr. Paul?
Yeah, you're right, but we didn't have no more security than that. But